ancient games and the study of ancient games. Okay. There's going to be little new that you will see here, and yet a lot that is eerily unfamiliar. When Ashwini approached me for a name, I thought of made this name up. So in the Hori tradition of giving names in Greek, I call this Archaeo Paizology. Archaeo is of course old, and Paizo is the Greek word to play. It can also be Paiho. And Logi, of course, you know Logi, okay? Now, this is an endeavor, although my name is associated with it. I can't really claim to be the sole author of this. So I've tried to credit everyone who has walked with me on this journey. It's been a long journey starting in 2017. And this is now in its fourth year. And we hope it's going to be a journey that's going to go on for several more years. So let's dive into this. Okay. Now you've heard of two very different cultural sayings. One is all work and no play makes Jack a dull boy. From one end of the Indo-European spectrum, and our very own Indian saying, "Kheloge kudoge, banoge kharab, padhoge likhoge, banoge nawab." Okay. But, and that's a very big but, the history of humanity has been a very dull one without its playful moments, okay? None of us likes a person who is 100% serious, 100% focused, lacking in a sense of humor or playfulness, right? And to tell you a story, games also give little windows into reality. Okay. In some sense, a game is like a surreal world. The moment you are into the game, you are effectively out of the real world. Whether you're playing a game of football, where getting the ball into the goal is your only focus, or you're playing chess, or a game like Fox and Geese, or you're in the boxing ring, all your worldly worries are lost and you're only focused on outwitting your opponent or achieving the purpose of that game. Okay? But the only other kind of space that can compete with this sense of otherworldliness is religion. Right? The whole goal of religion is also that when you pray, you escape the mundaneness of this current world and you escape into a spiritual and a completely ethereal world. And in some sense, these two have long competed with each other. So there is a very long list of religious complaints against people playing games. And in our times, I think religion has finally won over and the playing of games is now considered a childish thing, a time pass, or a waste of time, or something to do only when you have idle time at hand. It is considered a distraction from the main purpose of your existence, which is, of course, to provide labor for capital, right? If at the end of this lecture you think I'm a Marxist, I'm not going to count to you. Huh? But play is integral to who we are as human beings. It's in fact integral to who we are as mammals. Because every known species of mammal is known to play. Okay, you will see kittens, puppies, calves, young dolphins running around, chasing each other, and engaging in mock battles, mock bites, right? And that's one reason why you're actually able to play with animals, because they share with you the sense of play. Okay, but what mammals don't share with the rest of mammalia does not share with us as humans is the notion of playing by the rules. Okay, so you can chase each other, tumble over each other, etc., but there aren't any rules. There are no points to be made, there are no goals to be scored, there are no dice to be thrown. So these are things that we humans invent. In fact, people who've studied games, and before me, there have been many giants who've studied games. And sometimes people have wondered whether our sense of rules came from games and then went to the rest of society, or we applied rules to society first and then brought them to games. Okay? I mean, there's a lot of places where we do a lot of ritualized behavior. Okay? So if you go to a court of law, for example, you have lawyers who have to dress in a certain kind of uniform. There are certain behaviors that they must indulge in. They have to address the judge in a particular way. You know, the whole thing is set out, you might say, like a game board, right? Similarly, there are other spaces where we have rules and rituals that we follow. The other thing is, of course, why we should really study games is that they are a window into our society. They tell us how imaginative our society is, depending on the kind of rules we invent for games. Okay? And they reflect a very deep inner self. Like we love trying out new food, we love trying out new games. Okay? Anyone who refuses to play a game will immediately be called a curmudgeon, somebody lacking in a sense of society, and so on. They also imbue a society with a sense of trust and a sense of knowing whom to believe, whom not to believe. So in some sense, the sports we play, whether it's football, cricket, or whether we play board games, they are rehearsals for real life. Okay. A very famous anthropologist, I'm sorry I don't get his name, was once working in Cyprus. And he needed to win over the confidence of the locals because he needed to get, you know, data about their daily lives. And he found that the best icebreaker was to play the game of backgammon. And he noticed that they observed him very carefully as to how he played at backgammon. And they were very, very vigilant about whether he was cheating. Okay, and he figured that they had a somewhat simple social rule, which was, if you're the kind that cheats at games, it's also likely that you're the kind who will cheat in real life, that you will cheat on in your relationships, you will cheat in your business transactions, and so on and so forth. Okay, of course, that is no guarantee that if you don't cheat at games, it doesn't mean that you will not cheat in society. But this is one of the ways in which society judges character. And when we are playing through our childhood and building relationships, it's how we play, right? That's why they call it the player's spirit. That you should learn to take loss with grace. That you should play by the rules. Okay? Our languages are full of metaphors that come from games. So games truly are humanity. They're also our heritage. Okay? In a large part, they are part of the intangible heritage of a community. They are the sort of secrets that communities share with each other. There's a particular way of playing a game within one community that may differ with another community. And that's a secret, or it's an open secret. That is something that is shared. Then games also are part of your tangible heritage. Okay, the kind of materials that you use to play games. Okay, I've known many South Indian families who are used to playing with cowries as randomizers. And they sort of get uncomfortable if the game, the cowries have to be replaced with dice. And I've known many North Indian families who are not very familiar with cowries because those come only from the coast. And they find it very odd to try and play with cowries. Okay. As I said, there is a certain sense of alchemy to all these games because the moment you are in that game space, so while I'm talking to in terms of board games, you're obviously outside the board. But then that little space of maybe 2 feet by 2 feet is a little magical space. That space is detached from the rest of the universe. Right? Or when you're playing football, you are within the play space. And again, that's a gigantic space, but then again, it's a magical space. Again, your only concern is to get the ball into the opponent's goal. At that time, you're not worried about your house loan. You're not worried about whether your wife is cheating on somebody or your children's education or about your parents' health or insurance or, you know, none of those things matter. The only thing that really matters is getting that ball into the goal. And of course, if you are a sports spectator, then you're participating in the game with your heart. At that point, again, all your worries are erased and you're just lost in the game. So they have served as these very ethereal spaces for millennia. It's only today I think they're under some kind of serious challenge with the invention of the television and later the mobile phone screen. And in these COVID times where we can't socialize, I think most of us have just chosen to drown our sorrows in Netflix, right? But for a very, very long time, games have been an unbreakable part of our culture. Anthropologists who record cultures, you know, have sadly not really focused too much on recording the games of a culture. And therefore, these things become among the most vulnerable aspects of a culture. They are the ones that can get lost the most easily. And when they do, it's a terrible tragedy. Okay. What's even more interesting is that games have also been a form of soft power. Okay. Now, this is a sense, a term that was coined in recent diplomacy, in that hard power comes from military force. It comes from your financial might and all of that. But soft power is the way your culture subtly influences other cultures. Okay? America is the prime example of hard power. It can send its armies into any country, it can throw money at anything, but it is also a giant in soft power, right? It has conquered the world with McDonald's, with Hollywood movies, and with many other aspects of its culture. Russia is an example of a hard power that hardly has any soft power. So while, yes, it has mighty armies and a nuclear arsenal and the power to blackmail countries with it, you know, with its oil wealth, there's very little Russian culture that has really seeped out into the world. We know a few Russian novels like those of Chekhov or Tolstoy, etc. But there's very little of Russian culture that we otherwise know. On the other hand, Japan, for example. After its disastrous loss in the Second World War, it has nevertheless become a ruthless soft power. There is almost no aspect of Japanese culture that has not seeped into the rest of the world. Across various time zones, different bits, So for example, I personally am also a writer of haiku and very strongly influenced by Japanese culture in that way. There are people here, I'm sure, who are ardent consumers of anime and manga. There are people who love karaoke. The more refined types might prefer ikebana. Okay? But there's almost no aspect of Japanese culture that has not seeped into the rest of the world. Even Japanese cuisine. So all of us practically have eaten ramen noodles, right? So the sense of soft power. Now, why am I talking a lot on this? It's because games are one of the easiest expressions of soft power, and they were so for a very long time. Okay? See, they are one of the most powerful memes in the world, in the sense that they cross barriers of class and caste, geography and history, language and religion, X and Y, A and B, etc., etc. There's nothing like, oh, this is a Russian game, we'll never play it. Or, oh, this is a Chinese game, we'll never play it. Or, oh, this is an Indian game, we should never play it. We have no such distinctions. We don't say this is a Dalit game, we Brahmins will not play it. Or that this is a Christian game, we Jews will not play it. Or there is never anything with games. Games are games. They're one of the most universal things. We are happily open to play anybody's games. Okay? So they very easily form bridges between cultures. They also act as tremendous bonds within cultures. You can always break the ice with a stranger by inviting him to play a game that both of you know mutually. And that acts as a social glue. Right? The only thing that beats games in their soft power is the power of a story. Okay, people love listening to stories even more so than they like playing games. Right? To the extent that when people play games, there are stories within the games. People will tell you stories of games that they have played. Right? So, for example, you get two cricket fans in a room together, they can very quickly talk about some random test that happened in 2006 in Australia, where somebody, Rahane was batting, and I'm sure somebody will correct me up now, that there was no test in which Rahane played in Australia in 2006. Things like that, right? People are, stories bring us even closer than games. But now stories have been studied because they become part of the literature of a culture, and literature is seen as one of the most important aspects of a culture. Games, unfortunately, for various reasons, largely because one, religion generally has a lot of antipathy to games, because both, you know, compete for that same mind space, that when you have free time, pray rather than play. And also a modern work ethic that makes sure that you're so dead tired at the end of the day that you're just idly watching TV rather than, you know, having to mentally engage in playing a game. Okay? Now, in some senses, they also mirror social strata. And here is an example. So, for example, on the left side, you see the game of Chopper. It's typically played by men from the upper castes or classes. It also often involved an ornate cloth board. And then you had to have pieces and you had dice. And if you were the Emperor Akbar, of course, you could afford to get a giant chopper board etched on the courtyard of your palace in Fatehpur Sikri. And you had slave girls dressed up in different colors to act as the pawns. Right? But it was, in general, a game meant for the rich. And it has a certain association with richness. On the other hand, there is the game of Aath Challas, or known as Kavadi Khela. It has multiple names, okay? Daya Kattam, etc. Now, this is one of the most common games across the country. I have seen it all the way from Punjab to Tamil Nadu, from Gujarat to Assam. Everybody plays it. The game board pattern is identical. The position of the crosses may change. So this is a 5x5, but there may be other patterns like 7x7 or 9x9. Or in my family, at one wedding, we had a mammoth pattern of 13x13. Okay, so the game rules are simple. Everybody, there are four players or four teams of players. Everybody starts on one of these outside crosses, and then you have to go right inside. And then the rest of the rules are pretty similar to chopper. There are dice throws. There are, if you get six, for example, that's a double throw. Then you can pair your pawns and move them with even throws of the dice, etc., etc. This is a game which is so familiar, I'm not going to dive into it. If you want me to tell the rules, I will tell them after this talk. Now, this is very common, but it is not played among the elite. I have not come across similarly fancily embroidered or stitched Archchalas boards. The pawns are very simple. They are often played with cowries rather than dice. Okay. If cowries are not available, seeds are used, which are rubbed so that one end is convex and the other end is flat, and so on and so forth. I mean, this is a board etched on the floor of a temple in Badami, but very often they are just etched, you know, after a hard day's work in the agricultural field. You just sit down at the side of the field, scratch this board into the mud, and you play. And this is totally disposable. The moment the game is over, you have used random pebbles and seeds for your pawns. You can throw those away. Your dice, which were improvised from, say, tamarind seeds, can be thrown away. There is no great mehnat of craftsmanship involved. Unlike these, which are often precious heirlooms, and passed down from families to families. So, in some sense, they do mirror social strata. Okay? As I showed you the floor graffiti at Badami, collected by my colleague Riddhi Joshi, we've noticed that games are not itched. On caves and temple floors, on forts, houses, etc., across the country. So before we came into the picture and made headlines with the Hindu article, there were a lot of people who were quietly doing work, okay? The famous Ramson's Trio, based in Mysore, have been collecting games for many years now. Balamba Ramaswamy, Minita Siddhartha have been doing this in Tamil Nadu. Dr. Demme Raja Reddy has been doing this in AP. Mr. Pankaj Bhosle has been doing this in Maharashtra. But a lot of people working in isolation. And now this is a country which has thousands of temples, hundreds of forts. So clearly there is tons and tons of data still to be collected. Okay. So very few people realize that if you walk into a temple and you look down, beneath your feet, you will often find something like Mankala pits or a chopper or an Archchalas or many other games that were scratched into the floor, often by your own ancestors, perhaps a couple of centuries ago. Some of these games are seriously old. Some of them are relatively newer. But just as much as many of our temples from, say, the Chalukya period or the say the Orissa Gajapati period, so on and so forth, are living temples still in worship. Similarly, they have games still etched on their floors, and occasionally people do still play those games. Okay. Sadly, today these board games are under severe threat. One is, of course, TV, radio, video games, Netflix, etc. Pose a universal threat to board games, whether they are modern or traditional board games. Okay. Then, of course, there are a few commercially manufactured board games, you know, which are backed by heavy marketing budgets. like Monopoly, for example, one of the most sold games in the world. So if you, any of you who has watched The Big Bang Theory, you will be exposed to a whole number of board games that feature in that television series. Okay. In South Asia, there's an additional threat apart from, you know, people just forgetting about their board games. Many of these board games are actually erased. So many temple floors are often refloored, or the entire temple is pulled down and rebuilt. Okay. So the concept of restoration or jirnodhar, okay, which is a belief traditional to Hindus, Buddhists, and Jains, but in India also Muslims, Jews, and Christians also do this, that when a temple or church or mosque or derasar gets old, the building structure is not very stable, it is simply pulled down without any regard to its history or its archaeology, and a fresh thing is put up, often a brick and cement structure, very often simply clad in marble, following a whole lot of modern stylistic preferences. The old statuary pillars are just thrown aside. Now, what does happen to the games is, of course, those other things of least concern, that they are often just completely wiped out. Even if the temple per se may not be pulled down, people are often tempted to, you know, the old stone floor is no longer considered prestigious enough. So nowadays there is this fashion to put a very shiny granite floor, or just to show that you have the monetary muscle, it has to have a very shiny marble slab. Okay. Which unfortunately completely erases that heritage that was etched on the floor of the temple. Apart from this, in many monuments that are protected by the state departments of archaeology or the Archaeological Survey of India, and we have been trying to sensitize them too, at least in Maharashtra we have had a sympathetic ear. Very often to protect the monument, or because it has been eroded by rain for many hundreds of years and the surface has become uneven and tourists complain, it is often cemented over, and then again you lose this heritage. Okay. So these are the sort of urgent needs as to why one should be studying board games. Okay. Now, what is the study doing? So I'll give you a bit of history, because, you know, I am an archaeology history buff. Okay. Now, we must, of course, start at the very beginning. So we will start with the world's oldest games. And they are the world's simplest games. They're played everywhere in the world. Okay. There isn't a place in the world where this game is not played. In English, it is called jacks or knuckle bones. And every culture has its own name. The name is usually based on the kind of material used to play. So it's often seven of each kind. So by the seashore, most people play with shells or cowrie shells. People play with different kinds of seeds. So in Tamil Nadu, this game is called Puliyangottai because it's played with seven tamarind seeds. In Maharashtra, it's called Sagar Gote because it's played with the seeds of a plant of the same name. In other places, it's called Seven Stones. Okay. It consists of a very simple trick that the seven stones are thrown onto the floor. You pick one and toss it into the air, and before it can fall down, you must catch the rest. Okay. And then there are many variations. You try and catch the stone on the back of your palm. You try and catch it on your palm. You have to catch it between your fingers. Then you throw one and you grab two. You throw two and you grab three. All kinds of rules that change according to the people who play it. But this game is so old that it has actually been found from even Paleolithic sites. In fact, people have found these tiny sheep bones known as knuckle bones, which are really tiny ones. They just small. But people have found that these bones are gathered and kept at one place. And that has been therefore one of the oldest games in the world. The other game is probably dice. Okay? Nothing more than a betting game. And not dice in the form that I've shown you, but simply the fact that you throw something and you tell somebody to predict the outcome. So in a dice, you roll the dice and say, what will it finally land on? Okay? Or you may throw cowries and ask people to bet on that. And so on and so forth. And in fact, this game is so old that it is mentioned in the Rig Veda. Rig Veda has this absolutely beautiful Sanskrit poem called The Gambler's Lament, which talks about how a person got so addicted to gambling that he gave away all his property, and then his children left him, his wife left him, and then he was reduced to penury, and it should be a warning that the temptation to gamble is very strong, and so on and so forth. Okay, and to date, we have seen that the temptation to gamble is so strong, it's actually considered a terrible social ill. There are many religious prescriptions. So Islam prescribes some terrible hells that you will land up in if you gamble. Hinduism has several other verses in various other books. Christianity forbids it. Every religion I know of forbids gambling. Okay. In fact, we've come to believe that the game that was played in the Mahabharata, known as the Dyuta, was nothing more than a simple gambling game. Okay. That something akin to dice. Okay. We believe that these were the seeds of the Aksha plant, very closely related to the Rudraksha. The dried seeds of this would be thrown, and then you had to guess the number that would land face up. Or something. That's something that has been covered by Renate Sayat, and that's published. But yeah, these are the two of the world's oldest games. One is a game of skill and one is a game of chance. And it is from these two kind of games that the rest of the world's board games have emerged. Okay, I am very careful not to include physical sports in this talk, largely because A, that has been studied to a great extent. There is an entire industry built around it. There are several academic disciplines around it, whether it comes from sports medicine or sports theory, the history of sport, everything has been covered. Okay. Some sports are games like football and cricket, some are not, like the athletic sports, which is just a measure of strength and agility and physical characteristics. And some, like boxing, are almost entirely mental games. Okay. You might think that it's a very brutish game for louts because you just have to bash up each other. But under the current rules and all, it is almost entirely a mental game more than it is a physical game. But I'm not covering all of those because, as I said, there is enough done in the world about them. Board games in India, especially, are the ones that are a neglected field of study. And therefore, those are the ones that I'm going to be covering. But from these very, very basic ideas of games comes this concept of ludimes. Okay? And the concept of ludim was given by the great game theorist, theorist of board games called David Pallett, who's the great-grandfather of modern game studies. Okay? So he invented a concept called a ludium. Now, a ludium is a bit like a gene, in the sense that the gene is the smallest unit that codes for some part of your physical body. Similarly, the ludim is the smallest part of a game that can stand by itself. And then a combination of ludims basically makes up a game. Okay? To give you a very, very simple example, you take the game of snakes and ladders. Okay? In its current role, stripped of all its spiritual and historical significance, it is nothing but a square of 10 by 10. Okay? Where if you move by throwing a die, okay, die is singular, dice is plural. So this should be cubic die, not dice, my bad. You throw a die, and then whatever number the die throws up, that dictates your move. So that is one ludim. Okay. Then the second ludim is the fact that you are playing on a board of 10 by 10, so that's 100 squares. That is the limited space in which you play. The third ludim is that if you land on specific squares, you are automatically bumped up to a higher numbered square. And the fourth ludim is that if you land on certain other squares, you are brought down to a lower numbered square. And that is the sum total of the game. Okay. And of course, the fifth ludim in that is that whoever manages to reach the 100th square, the first is the winner. Okay, so that's the modern game of snakes and ladders broken up into its five ludims. Okay, Europeans have used this concept of ludims ever since it was proposed way back in the 1970s. And ever since then, all kinds of new board games have been invented by mixing and matching ludims from many other kinds of games. Okay. And on the very, very rare occasion by inventing a new ludim. Okay. So with that, board games get another fillip as they increase in complexity. And the concept of the board itself comes into being. That it is a delimited space in this universe within which the game happens. Okay. Until then, for example, whether you have the game of dice or the game of jacks, there was no specifically delineated space. Right? But now you had a board with markings and all that, and on which then you had governed moves. So you either move left or right or ahead or backwards or diagonally. All of these are chess moves, of course. And the number of squares you move was determined by a dice. Or in chess, for example, these are predefined. And so on and so forth. So chess is one of those very rare games which is played on a board without dice at all. Now, one of the earliest games that we know in the world is the game of 20 squares. Okay? It dates back right into the royal oldest layers of Bronze Age Egypt. Okay. There are many versions of it and it has been found all over the world. On the left is a box from an Egyptian tomb. Okay. You see two different players, one with conical pieces and one with cylindrical pieces. And these are sheep knuckle bones used as dice. Okay. On the right, you see this very elaborate game board made up of wood and enameled with various precious stones, including blue lapis lazuli, which was discovered from a royal tomb in Ur, because of which this game is also known as the royal game of Ur. And then there are flat discs, one blue with white dots and one white with blue dots that are used as playing pieces. And there are pyramidal die that are thrown. On the bottom left is the same game, but now etched on the floor of a sentry's little guardhouse in somewhere in Mesopotamia. So it wasn't just a royal game, but was also played by the common people. and on the bottom right you get again the game of 20 squares from the Giroft culture. Okay, so if you're familiar with the Shahri Sokhta, or known as the burnt city, which was in the Iranian plateau, the earliest culture in Iran, the earliest urbanized culture in Iran, contemporaneous to the Harappan culture and probably interacting with it. Now, this had a very fancy terracotta board where the squares were marked by intertwined snake bodies. Okay, so a lot of the stuff that comes from Giroft consists of snake motifs. So this game is seen from various parts of the Near East. Okay. Now, when it was, so here are, for example, various examples. On here, this is from the BMAC culture. On the bottom right is from Dholavira. It is an incomplete board, but looks very tantalizingly like the game of 20 squares. And in fact, game historian Irving Finkel has hypothesized that the game may originally have come from Harappa. Okay. Now, interesting thing was that this game was a fossil game. It was found in tombs and burials all over the ancient world, but no one knew its rules. It was a completely dead and fossilized game. Okay, fossilized in a very literal sense, because the traces of the game had been now mineralized. They were just traces in clay and stone. The living tradition of the game had completely died out. Or had it? Okay. Interestingly, Irving Finkel, who is not just a game historian, but also his actual day job is curator of the Assyrian section of the British Museum. Okay. The British Museum is the most fantastic place on earth. It has sections on every part of the world, because the British managed to obtain stuff from all over the world. And one day he discovered a tablet, which on casual reading seemed to suggest that something happens on this square and something happens on that square. And he was very perplexed. And then when he finally deciphered the entire tablet, he found out that this was actually the rules for the game of 20 squares. So here's one of those very, very rare cases in which a fossilized game was brought back to life by a fossilized tablet, which had the original rules. Now, this is the world's oldest rule book of games. And then he goes on to describe in his paper that, now Irving Finkel is Jewish and he reads magazines about Jewish life. And in one of the magazines, when he was casually flipping over, he noticed a game board which was identical to this very, very Maha ancient game board. And it was said that this was the game of Asha, which was being played by the last of the Cochin Jews. And then he goes on to tell a fantastic story of how he did some research on the Cochin Jews. He figured out that most of them had migrated from India to Israel. He contacted his sister who lived in Israel. And he told her to go to the Cochin Jewish settlement. So most of them live in one town in Israel. And his sister then drove all the way to that town, and she went from house to house asking if anybody remembered the game. And many of them were old people who said, I know we used to play it in childhood, but I don't remember. Until his sister finally met one lady by the name Ruby. I forget her full name. I think she was Ruby Thomas, who remembered playing the rules of the game. And when his sister told him, he took the first flight out of London to Jerusalem, went to that lady's house. So this board, this lovely ornate board that you see here, obviously sits in the British Museum. And he had a copy of this board and he took it to her, and she played the game with him. She told him the rules that she had played with. And they were the very same rules that he had deciphered on this tablet. So a game that had died out in the ancient world had lived on in India for 2 millennia. Okay. Now this is of course, the king of all games, the only game that has been ever given the rank of a sport, which has its own international federation, which has its celebrated grandmasters, right? This game was born in India. In fact, a lot of archaeological research has now gone on to prove that the game actually originated in Kannauj. And a lot of this comes from sources from Persian literature. So there is this Persian text called the Vizarishni Chatrang, which says that there was an Indian king who sent across the game to the Persian emperor with a challenge that his court people must decipher how to play the game. So it consisted of a very beautifully embroidered silk cloth of 64 squares, 16 pieces of emerald and 16 pieces of rubies, okay, which were carved into various shapes. And the story goes, I'll tell you the story later on, okay, because that's part of another aspect of games. The thing is, some suggest that this was actually invented as a teaching tool to teach princes the art of warfare. That so there is an ancient game in India whose rules are completely forgotten, called Ashtapada, but with whose game board consists of 8x8 squares. Okay, but we do not know any of the rules of Ashtapada. Sadly, there is no Indian manuscript or ancient text that talks about Ashtapada. Okay, the Ramayana does mention that Ayodhya was built like an Ashtapada board. But beyond that, we'll move on. Okay? And in the Harsha Charita, which is many centuries later, there is very, very beautiful passage of which two words are the ones that come to my memory the most. Ashtapadanam Chaturanga Kalpana. Okay? In fact, the poet Bana goes on to say that Harsha has established peace across India to such an extent that the only armies that now move are the ones on the Ashtapada board. So the word Chaturanga means army in ancient Sanskrit, because the army was made up of four elements. The elephants, the chariots, the horses, and the foot soldiers. Okay, so that was the four parts of the army, and therefore Chaturanga. And in Harshacharita, he says, Ashtapadanam Chaturanga Kalpana. So the only way of imagining a war in the reign of Harsha was on an Ashtapada board. So that just established that chess was well known in India at the time of Harsha. And now research has shown that it was invented just a few decades ahead of Harsha. The dynasty that precedes him was the Maukari dynasty, ruling at Kannauj. And historians say that chess probably originated in the court of that dynasty, either because some guru wanted to teach princes the art of warfare, and he took these clay models. So these are clay models that are now there at the Museum of Kannauj. I have seen them with my own eyes. It's almost like a pilgrimage for me. Okay. But that basically some guru arranged these pieces on a cloth to show how an army is assembled, that you keep the king and the minister in the center, that there is a row of infantry that is in the front in order to keep everybody protected. Then the gaja is next to the king, and then the ashwa, and then the chariots, and then the chariots need space because chariots can't turn easily. They have to move very straight, so they only like go up and down. The gaja is a, you know, heavy, powerful but heavy animal. It sort of moves slowly. The ashwa is a fast animal. It can jump over the others. And I believe that when the guru is teaching them, and behind the guru's back, the princes sort of invented the game of chess by playing with those pieces. Okay. There's also another very interesting story of how chess was invented. So this comes from a Arabic legend that there was an Indian king called Dab Shalim. Okay, not an Indian sounding name, but clearly a Persian or Arabic apabhrausha of an Indian name. What that Indian name was? Suspense. So this Dab Shalim was very fond of waging war. And he was always mounted on his horse. And he was always fighting with this king or the other king. Sadly, one day he came down with a disease where the doctor said that it will only get worse if you continue to sit on a horse or an elephant. Now, the only disease I know of which is made worse by sitting is piles. Okay? But, of course, the original literary source is silent on... it's sort of diplomatic because, you know, kings getting piles can be pretty embarrassing. So they say that Dab Shalim was very angry that he could no longer wage war. And that was his favorite activity. And that he called his entire court and he said, look, one of you has to find a solution to this. I give you all 24 hours. If within that time you don't have an answer, I will cut all your heads off. Okay? Very typical Maharaja story. So the story goes that all these ministers went back to their houses and they told their families that, well, my time has come. Tomorrow you're going to cut my head off. Let me, embrace my children one last time, this, that. And one of these ministers was doing all this mahasadly. And his son asked him, Baba, what is the problem? And he said, look, the king has given this order. Now, what am I going to do? And this son's name was Sasi. Or he's known as Sasa in the Arabian legends. Oh, Baba, don't worry. I will have a solution by morning. So apparently, Sasa was awake all night long. And he came up with a game of chess. And then he said, Baba, you take this cloth and all these pieces and show that to the king and how he can draw up a war sitting in his bed all the time. And the minister was very wary and he didn't know how the king will react. But he had to go with some answer. So he went to the king and he told him, look, this is my son. He made this thing. This is one army. This is the other army, and this is how you can move all the pieces and all. And the story goes that the king was overjoyed. And he immediately summoned the minister's son. And the moment the minister's son came, the story goes that the king fired all his ministers and appointed the son as his chief minister. So that's one of the stories of the origins of chess, which is told as an Arab legend about India. Sadly, I do not see any Indian source for the story, but it's a beautiful story nonetheless. Okay. How real is the story? Suspense. Now, this is a game which is way more popular in India than chess ever will be. Even though chess is called the king of games and the game of kings, and is popular the world over, it is not terribly popular in India. Indian kings have long enjoyed this game a lot more. Okay. Now, depending on the part of the country, it has different names. It's called Chopper, Chaucer, Chopard. It's called Saripat. It's called Patkrida. It's called Dayam. It has as many names, as many versions. It's also not a single game. Okay. It has some pretty simple ludims. One is, of course, this kind of board arrangement. Okay, 3x8 on all four sides and a central starting point. Four pawns for each player, sometimes eight pawns. They start here, then they have to go all the way around and they come back. Then there are rules for forming pairs, for moving pairs, then the numbers on the dice. Okay, so then whether it is played with dice or with cowries. And so different, the rules change from family to family, district to district, state to state. So it isn't a single game. It is like an entire family of games, all based on the same board. Okay. And we have all played this in the summer and one of the most aggravating games, because, you know, you may go through a lot of trouble, manage to come very close to when you're going back home, and then someone will come and cut you, which means you have to start all over again. Okay. So one of the most aggravated games. In fact, there is a modern version of the game sold by Hasbro, and the name is Aggravation, which is nothing but a simplified version of Pachisi. Okay. The oldest literary evidence for Pachisi is in the Skanda Purana, and another very, very fantastic story. Okay, I'll come to it. Now we have seen this board on the floors of the caves at Nashik and Ellora, which I have shown you earlier in the Vanishing Games bit. But let me just go back and show it. This image heavy and therefore tends to move slowly. So these were documented by my friends and colleagues at Nashik and at Ellora. I know they're from Nashik and Ellora. I can't now remember which is Nashik, which is Ellora. Ashwini can probably tell better. Yeah. So while they are found on the floors of the caves, we are not sure whether they go back to the same dates of the games or don't. Okay. I have my personal reasons to believe that the Nashik ones are much later than the caves, whereas the Ellora ones are probably from the same time. Okay. Where we have actual proof is Akbar's game at Fatehpur Sikri, because that is also there in the Aine Akbari. There's both literary and archaeological evidence for that. Yeah, but the literary evidence for the game of Pachisi is in the Skanda Purana. And the story goes that, so it also has its mystical elements in that the four wings of the game represent the four directions. Okay. This represents Kailash, which is the center of the world. So the four colors of the pawns are variously interpreted either as the four castes or the four stages of life. Okay. Or the four aims of a Hindu: Dharma, Artha, Kama, Moksha. The four is a big number in Hinduism. So that, and that basically the journey that you go around the whole board is the journey of your life from birth to death. So it has a lot of spiritual, mystical significance, all of these things. These are part of almost every game, has like associations of what it is and what it is not. Okay. So the say the legend goes that in the Skanda Purana, which is dated to the 8th century, the text said that Shiva one day invented this game with all of this meaning, and he taught it to Parvati. Okay. And the dice, there are two dice used, which represent either day and night, or dharma and karma, okay, or luck and hard work. It is interpreted in different ways. And when he taught it to Parvati, she said, okay, lovely game, let's play. And she beat him. Okay. And it wasn't just played for fun. There were stakes involved. So they bet various things. Okay. So they played one round, Parvati beat him, and then he had to forfeit something, and then a second and a fourth. And by the time it came to the end, Shiva had lost everything. He had lost his Ganas, he had lost Nandi, he had lost the Chandra on his head, he had lost the snake that he wears as his ornament. Okay, she only spared him his langot. Okay, so he was Shiva. He went into completely Rudra mode, and he went to the banks of the Ganga, and he was sitting there and fuming. See, she had beaten him fair and square, so it wasn't like he threw a thunder or destroy the world or whatever. He just had to pull off. And then the story goes that Skanda came and found that his father was very sad and morose. And he asked him, Papa, what's wrong? And then Shiva told him the story of how he lost everything to Parvati. And then Skanda said, oh, that's it. I'll go challenge Mummy and I will win back everything for you. So Skanda went back, said, Mom, I heard you beat Dad at this game. Why don't you play with me? And over multiple sessions, he beat his mother fair and square and won back everything that belonged to Shiva. Now it was Parvati's chance to be completely grumpy and morose, and Shiva and Skanda were celebrating. Now, of course, you have to have Ganpati coming into the picture, and he goes and asks his mother, hey, what is the problem? And she tells him everything. Ganpati took one look at the game and said, oh, nothing, I can beat both of them in a trice. So he went and challenged his father and his brother. And so the story goes that he completely beat them, and not only did Shiva again lose his Chandra, his Trishul, his Nandi, his Ganas, but Skanda also lost his flag and his crown and his peacock and his weapons and everything, you know. And then who has to come into this picture? Narad, of course. And then this is basically nothing but a treatise against gambling. And Narad then gives them all four a long lecture of how this game can completely destroy families if it is played with fun, it's fine, then it can unite families and entertain them on long nights like Diwali when this game is traditionally played. But if you bring gambling into this, it will ruin families. Okay, so this is another narrative, and one of my aims in studying this is to collect these narratives. Again, these are very many beautiful stories that would again get lost if we let these games go extinct. As I told you, the only thing more powerful than a game is the story around the game. Okay? There are many other games also that are played in India. So one of these is this game called Al-Kirk, known as Al-Kirkat in Arabic. And this is a game that was originally invented in Arabia. Okay? Which also, like chess, mimics the conflict between two armies. But unlike chess, the armies are all equals. So there are no kings or ministers or elephants or kings. It sort of takes the local situation of the Arabs, where there are just two bands of soldiers fighting each other. Okay? And this, since its invention in Arabia, the oldest reference is literal, which is the Kitab al-Aghani of the 9th century, and there is nothing older than that. We don't have any physical evidence of this game in Arabia. But this is the one reference we have. But it soon spread from Arabia. It came to India. It came to Europe. In Europe, then later on, it met chess. And the combination of Al-Kirk and chess finally became the game of draughts. So instead of playing the game on a grid like this, where the pieces are kept on the points, the same game is played now on a chessboard. Okay. In Asia, this game then really flowered, because there are dozens and dozens of variants of Al-Kirk. Okay. So in India, it, for example, acquired all kinds of extensions in the terms of wings. So there may be two wings, four wings, 8 wings, okay. Also, people in India figured that the same board can be used for two vastly different kinds of games. So this here, for example, is a version of Al-Kirk, okay, with 4 wings, okay. And there are how many? 12 on the main board, and then 6 plus 6. So 24 versus 24. So this is a more longer lasting game. It's actually a pretty fast game of skill and strategy. You move your piece, the other one cuts it, then you cut him, then he cuts you, like that, and it can end very quickly. But Indians figure out there is also another way of playing the game, and that is a hunt game, in which the two players are not equal. One player is the hunter and the other player is the hunted. Okay. See, here's a version called Elephants and Soldiers, which is popular in Karnataka. And there are many other games. They're called Sheep and Tiger and Sheep, Tiger and Goats, Leopards and Sheep, Leopards and Buffaloes, all kinds of combinations. Okay. But basically, one is the hunter and one is the hunted. And it's a game of tremendous skill, and very often you think that the player who's playing the hunter has the easier thing, but a very, very experienced player will often play the hunted. He will take sheep versus and let you take tigers, and then he will beat the living daylights out of you. Okay. So again, Al-Kirk is played all over the world. As I told you, in Europe, it became draughts. This is a version played in Africa, where the board is multiplied by 4. Okay. So you take this board and then you extend it here, and then you extend it double, so that instead of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 points, you have 6, 7, 8, 9. So you have a 9 by 9 thing, and it's a far more complicated board. Takes a lot more time to play, a lot more intellectual investment in that. Okay, so it's a game that is played now all over Europe, Africa, and Asia. Okay, so here are the various versions of the game that are played just in the Western world, starting with Al-Kirkat. Moving on to the Spanish Al-Kirk, and then European drafts, various African versions, and then some of them went with Arab traders to Southeast Asia, and then there are many Southeastern versions. And then Alka came to India, where it then became part of multiple games. Okay, so Indians, when it comes to games, are hyper inventive, and they took a very basic game and then they invented the devil out of it. Okay, apart from that, Indians have many other games of their own that are also hunt, and both war games and hunt games, but played on various different kinds of boards. Okay, so this is a very famous Indian game called Tiger and Goat, and here you see the two champion players of Maharashtra state playing this game. Okay, so this is called the Puli Judam family of games. The word comes from Telugu. Puli means tiger, Judam means war. Okay, so it's basically a game of sheep versus tigers. This is often based on a very triangular board. This is something I grew up playing with my grandfather. He would let me play tiger, and he would lose a couple of games, and then when I got overconfident, he would completely destroy me by playing sheep. Okay, so much for the history of games. Now, I've obviously not covered the history of all the games played in India. I've left out this huge family of Mankala, simply because if, like I told Shreya when I was planning this lecture, that she asked me how long would you like it, and I said 3 days. And she thought I was joking, but honestly, I can tell you, if I try to give you the history of every game I've collected in the last 4 years of research, I could just go on and on and on. I'm also, and you know, I like the sound of my own voice and can go on talking. Okay. Now from history, let's move on to geography. Okay. Now games are interesting. As I said, they are very permeable. They can be transmitted across cultures very, very easily. Okay. So all these fancy things that you see are nothing but boards of the game of 20 squares, all of them from the giraffe culture. Okay. But you can see that various adaptations have been made. Okay. There are eagles, there's a humanoid scorpion, there's a scorpion. With a board on a table with legs. So clearly it was such a popular pastime that all kinds of fancy variants were made. Okay. The interesting thing is, when games are transmitted, the more complex the game is, the lower the rate of innovation, okay, and greater the fidelity. So the example I'll give you is chess. Chess is such a complicated game that even though it is spread all over the world, the rules of chess haven't changed really a great deal. Nobody has really experimented too much with the board or with the pieces. Okay. Whereas with a game like Alka, which is very simplistic, there has been an explosion of variation. Okay. Apart from that, now the diffusion patterns of board games also change. Chess has diffused comparatively slowly, because it's a complex game. Other games like Pachisi have diffused much faster. Okay, therefore every board game has its own story and which needs to be told. Okay, another thing is games that are easy to cross. Some games are deeply culturally linked, like for example, Pachisi had a lot of stories about the world and the four directions and day and night and dharma, karma, all of that. So now these are very local things that don't easily go across. So Pachisi, for example, is played around the world today, and I'll show you how. But it does not carry all those aspects. Okay. And here are examples of how in various periods of the world's history, the games have been traded all over the world. So as the game of 20 squares, as I told you, was very common in the ancient world. From the Indus to Cyprus, and from Egypt to the BMAC, okay? The game of chess starts in the early historical period, traveling from India to Persia and then to the rest of the world. During the Indo-Roman trade period, you have Roman games coming in and becoming part of our traditional games. And this continues across various periods as different games traverse the world. Okay? As I said, they are very good icebreakers. Everybody loves playing a new game. And therefore, they spread very easily. Okay? So to give you some examples. This is a game of 20 squares. And Alex de Woot has shown how this game has spread by collecting data from various archaeological reports. Okay? From the second millennium BC, from the third millennium BC right to the first millennium BC. This game sort of almost died out by the time of Christ. So, as I said, apart from that one corner of Cochin where it was still being played. Okay? So, all over the world. But you see that the oldest sites originate here at Giroft and at Tepe Yahya, which are both in eastern Iran, in the Balochistan region. And some have actually speculated that it may actually have come from the Harappan regions. Harappan archaeologists haven't paid any great interest in the games excavated from their sites. So the amount of data is poor and has not been analyzed very well. And I'm hoping somebody is inspired to go through old excavation reports and pull out that data and do it. Okay. Now, another Bronze Age game was the game of 58 holes. Okay. And this is a very beautiful specimen now in an American museum. But there are some pieces are represented by foxes with upright ears, and the remaining pieces are represented by domesticated dogs with flopped down ears. Okay. And the idea is that it's a race game. Okay. So both players start from a central place here, and they throw dice and take turns, and then they have to race down and then here and then come up here and then towards the common ending. And whoever gets there first wins. There is no cutting because the paths are completely different. They do not race on the same track. Okay? Which is very interesting. So the ludim of playing on the common track probably emerged at a different point of time. There is this, the game of 20 squares, which is also a race game, is halfway. So one player starts here, one player starts here, and then they come to the single common racetrack where there is a lot of cutting allowed, and then they race up to here, and then they go their separate ways here, and whoever gets all their points off the board first wins. So this is in some sense ancestral to Chaturanga, and through some convoluted method, probably did not Chaturanga, Pachisi, through some convoluted evolution probably did give rise to the game of Pachisi. We still don't know. Okay. Then of course, the very definition of soft power is of course the game of chess, right? To the extent that all kinds of words used in diplomacy like checkmate, stalemate, etc. originate from the chess game. Okay. And those of you who are old enough to remember would know the famous game between Boris Spassky and Ronald Fischer, played in 1972 in Reykjavik. Spassky representing the USSR and Fischer representing the USA. Probably because it came at the very height of the Cold War, two nuclear armed superpowers and all of that. Potentially the most famous game ever. Okay. Very interestingly, it has tremendous religious prohibitions against it. Christianity bans it. Islam bans it, Judaism bans it, Hinduism bans it if you gamble with it. Buddhism says it's not nice because it distracts you from your prayers, and many more. Even Confucianism in China bans it because it says it's a complete waste of time, where you could have been doing something productive instead. Now I'm going to tell you the famous story that I said will come. Okay? So the Visarishna Chatrang is a Persian manuscript which says that there was an Indian king called Devishaman who sent across a richly embroidered silk cloth along with 16 rubies and 16 emeralds and challenged the Persian king that if anybody in your court can decipher this game and beat my ambassador, then I will recognize that you are the greatest king in the universe. And if in 3 days none of them can do this, then you must recognize that I am the greatest king of the universe. Now, obviously, a challenge like that to somebody's king will never go down nicely. So the Persian emperor Khusro immediately summoned his entire court and said, I will cut off all of your heads if within 3 days you can't find an answer. So they all cracked their heads for the first day, nothing. The second day, nothing. And they all got mega worried that one more day and all of us are going to lose our heads. So then one of them said, you know what, let us appeal to the old Wazir Bozorg Meher, who was in jail for having offended the king for something. So they went to the king and they begged him to release Bozorg Meher, saying he's the wisest person in Persia and we can't crack it. And if he can't crack it, then happily please cut off our heads. The king looked at the smirking Indian ambassador and immediately sent orders to release Bozorg Meher. So Bozorg Meher came to the court and because of his imprisonment, he had almost turned blind, could hardly see. And then he was explained the whole thing. And then he said, well, let me challenge the Indian ambassador. So he said, well, you play this game with me. The Indian ambassador said, fine. He spread the cloth and he put all his pieces in a certain formation. Bozorg Meher mirrored this formation. Then the Indian ambassador made some moves. Bozorg Meher copied the moves. And the first game, Bozorg Meher lost disastrously, as was expected. Then he said, well, let's play another game. So again, the Indian ambassador who started, and this time the game ended in a draw. Okay. And then in the third challenge, Bozorg Meher defeated the Indian ambassador. And then he said, look, now I have completely cracked the game. This is how it played. And he explained the whole game to the king. And then, so this game was played between the Indian and the Persian in silence. That's another part of the story. And then the king asked, is this explanation right? And the ambassador said, yes, it is right. So then Bozorg Meher said, look, wait for one night. And I will give a gift which is suitable for the ambassador to take back to his king. So Bozorg Meher went back to his jail cell and sat up all night and invented the game of backgammon. It was actually a well-known game already, but he made some changes to the game of backgammon. Okay. And he came back to the king and said, look, this is the new and improved version and I'm going to name it after you as Nohear the Shir. Okay, that being one of the titles of the king, which later on became the short form Nard, by which name the game is still known in Iran. Okay, so there are again hundreds of versions of backgammon. There's a Turkish version, an Iranian version, Central Asian version, an Azerbaijani version. There was a Mughal version, which is now we've lost it, and so on and so forth. And this Nard board was with similarly there were 15 jeweled pieces for each player, and the backgammon board and everything, and it will send and says, now you crack the game. Okay, if you Indians can crack the game, then we will admit that you are the greatest, and if you can't, you admit that we are the greatest. And the Visarishna Chatram concludes that, of course, the Indian couldn't crack it, and they had to pay salam to the Iranian ambassador. Okay? Now, this the only thing I want to add is, the game of chess is still played almost addictively in Iran. And to the extent that many Iranians love the game, and many mullahs then get angry and issue fatwas. Whereas it's been a very long time since anyone in India ever played backgammon. Okay? But now comes the story. Who was this Devi Sharma? And what relation has it to do with Dabshalim? Okay? So the Indologist Renate Sayer of Germany believes that she's cracked this puzzle. So looking at various records, she starts with Harsha's, with Bana's Harsha Charita, where he says Ashtapadanam Chaturanga Kalpana, which is the earliest reference to Chaturanga as a game. And then she goes back, Harshavardhan was of course the brother-in-law of the last Maukari ruler. And that Maukari ruler's grandfather was a king whose coins call him Deva Sharva Varman. And Sayyid thinks that it is the Persian couldn't pronounce Deva Sharva Varman all that correctly, and they called him Devi Sharma. Okay? The Persian manuscript gives us a clue, because it says Devi Sharma was the Rai of Kannauj. And Kannauj was certainly the capital of the Maukaris at that point of time. She says that the game of Chaturanga was probably invented just before the time of Deva Sharva Varman, and that he sent an ambassador. He does, by the way, overlap with the king Khusro, so that gives even more confidence in this conclusion that he was the king who sent an embassy. And the, for example, kings used to send embassies to each other. That was part of regular diplomacy. And so it's not unlikely that he would have been delighted with this game of chess and sent it as a gift to the Iranians. Now, whether the challenge was also sent is not necessarily. That's part of an Iranian legend. There is nothing to say that Deva Sharma Varman would have unnecessarily challenged the Emperor Khusrau, or vice versa. But it is known that Deva Sharma Varman had battled many other kings and conquered a lot of other smaller kingdoms. So him being the warlike Dabshalim, so maybe the Arabs just didn't get Deva Sharma Varman correct, and just in their language it ultimately became Dabshalim. That, and therefore we don't know if the legend of Sahasi is true. Probably not. But it is quite likely that some minister or guru to one of the Maukari rulers would have come up with a game. Because the complex game requires a lot of time and the kind of leisure that only noble people would have had. Plus, of course, the whole thing about war strategy and all is something only the elite indulge in, right? It has never been a game for farmers, and very few people who have any interest in farming have an interest in chess. So all of these point to the fact that chess was probably genuinely invented in Kannauj in just before the period of Deva Sharva Varman, which would make it around the 4th or 5th century. I'm not sure of these dates. I am an archaeologist, not a historian. I'm horrible at dates. And that this is the sort of proof we have. It is not completely settled. In fact, some people have suggested that we need to do an archaeological excavation at Kannauj. Strangely enough, Kannauj has never been excavated archaeologically, in spite of its historicity. I've been to Kannauj. It has a huge archaeological mound. They're just waiting for somebody to apply for permission and start excavating. I don't know why ASI has never excavated the ground. But it has its priorities. I'm no one to question them. Some people believe that if you excavate, you will start finding a lot of chess pieces and that will finally seal the hypothesis. I don't know. But very interestingly, chess has now spread all across the world and through various means. Okay. So chess went from India to Iran through diplomacy as the relations between Devasharma Varman and Khusro show. When the Arabs conquered Iran, it went, so Chaturanga becomes Chatrang in Iran. And when the Arabs conquer Iran, they get addicted to the game and the Arabs call it the game of Shatranj. They can neither say Cha nor Ga, so those letters became Sh and J, so Chatrang became Shatranj. From the Arabs via conquest, it reached Iberia, where in the Spanish language it is known as Ajedrez. And then through European trade networks, it spread all over Europe, where finally it reached the UK, where the name chess came to be. But also via various other trade networks, from Arabia, the game spread to Madagascar, where there is a Madagascar version of the game. And from India, via various trading networks, it also spread into Southeast Asia. And it reached China and Japan, where there are two very distinct versions of the game called Shangchi and Shogi. Okay, now Shogi is a very, very subtle game. The pieces are not these beautiful shaped chess pieces, but they're all little tiles with the name of the piece written on the tile. And the rules are a lot more complicated. In China, the game became Shangchi. Shangchi is the Chinese word for elephant. But the rules have changed to suit China. So they know nothing of the elephant. For Chinese battle, I mean, firstly, it's a tropical animal, doesn't do very well in China. So elephants are rarely found outside of the southern fringes of China. So it has never been a very popular battle animal. And so in Chinese chess, the elephant's role is relegated. The Chinese also divide the entire battlefield into two with a river in between. And as per their thing, the elephant cannot cross the river. Now, if anyone who's seen an elephant knows that they are fantastic swimmers. So anyway, but the Chinese invented a new piece called the cannon. Okay, that's because they were obviously familiar with gunpowder and cannon warfare long before anybody else was. So they choose to have that, and that's one of the strongest powers. Okay, but otherwise the game is in many ways similar to Chaturanga. And then through various trade networks, various kinds of chess went left, right, and center. So this is one of those beautiful examples of how games can, whether you are the conqueror or the conquered, whether you are a trader or a slave, this games can permeate all kinds of barriers. Okay, similar form of evolution is with the game of Pachisi. Again, it's a game that starts in India, and once the Delhi Sultanates and the Mughals come in, the game travels back into West Asia, where in Iraq, Syria, Lebanon, Jordan, and all, it is very popular as the game of Burgess. Okay, in fact, it forms the part of a woman's dowry. So this young women will actually make themselves a full Burgess kit. They will sew a whole Burgess board, and then they get carpenters to make pawns for them. And they love to play to cowries. So those cowries are specially imported from India. And from the Arab world, it went to Spain, where the game is called Parchis. And then from Spain, it went to the New World, where in Colombia, a version of the game is played called Parques. And with the Spanish immigrants, it also reached America, where the version played is called Parchisi. Okay. Then a second migration of the game happened when the British turned up in India and they saw Pachisi and they took it back with them to the UK, where it became a very, very simplified form called Ludo, which they have subsequently exported all over the world to the extent that now we Indians, we play this simplified British version of the game. We make apps and all for this, and we are beginning to forget our own original version of the game. Okay, and then there are many other versions now that have been invented by various communities as well as by commercial corporations. Okay, Alcock again. Again, through multiple trade routes, through conquests, through missionaries, this game has spread all the way from Arabia throughout various parts of Africa, to Madagascar, to India, to Southeast Asia, China, okay? And then even into the New World. And in India, it has blossomed. And so there are dozens of varieties of Alcock just in India, known only in India and played nowhere else. But distinctly all developed from Alcock. Okay? And then the game of Tiger and Goat. Now, this is even more complicated. It is not a game preferred by royal people, so it's not documented very well. So it's not quite clear as to where it originated and which way it went. There are different versions of this game, and you will see that they are played in very diverse geographies. Okay? So it's not very clear whether it originated in Southeast Asia and came to India or the reverse, and which game went to which part of the world. But it's a very absorbing game, very diverse. Okay, so all of this has been the history and geography of games. Now I'll come to this field that I invented called archaeopaleology, and what exactly do we study under this? Okay, so now the prior studies of ancient Indian games are fairly limited. There are just a handful of books on the subject. There are a lot more books on games from Arabia and Europe. Okay, and there is no shortage of books on the history of chess. But these are all about the history of chess in Europe. Okay, so barring some of these forerunners, okay, there is very little publication from India. Okay, my group is actively challenging this, and there are a lot of papers coming into the press. Okay, what do we need to do? Okay, so one of the things is we need to start documenting all these board games that are etched on the floors of various monuments before they are flowed over or other damage happens. The next is we need to try and figure out the dates of these games to figure an upper and a lower limit to the date range. The oldest, of course, is that the game and the monument are of the same date. Okay, to some extent, that some have theorized that the game may have been made by the people who are making the monument, and that the workers, when they took breaks, they played the games, and then when they finished, the games were etched on the floor and they left them like that and they carried on. There are other hypotheses that say that no, these games are actually much, much later, once the monument has been completely abandoned. And then people don't know what to do with it. And then random shepherds and people are coming and passing time in these caves or temples. And then they're making these games. Okay. Although anybody who knows anything about shepherds will tell you that they barely have time to certainly seclude themselves from their flock and sit and play games. They do play games, but they always make sure they have one sharp eye on what their flock of sheep or cows are doing. Okay, so many games have actually been shepherds games. Like, we believe that the tiger and goat game was invented by shepherds minding goats and keeping an eye out for tigers. Okay, but that these would be played in the open and not in secluded caves like that. Plus, there are many games that are still played in ancient temples when the temple continues to be in worship. So it's not like the games came only after the temple was abandoned. So it's not easy to date these games at all. Then of course we need to try and figure out the context of the game, what class was playing them, what caste and religion were playing them. So sometimes you see certain games are played right outside the temple, but not within the compound of a temple. That tells you that this game was mostly played by some lower caste people. Sometimes you see the game etched right close to the Garbhagriha, which might imply that the priests were playing the game. And many priests still play games, especially Mangala games. Okay? So these kind of spatial information is something we want to collect. We need to corroborate these with literary sources. And finally, establish some way of musealizing these games, making sure that they are preserved, not just as artifacts of monuments, but also as living games, that people should actually come back and play these games and bring them to life. Okay. So many of my students and associates have gone out and looked at these games. So Sojwal Sali, whose paper is in press, found some of these games at Nashik caves, and whereas many other caves in Maharashtra. Okay. He even found an ancient backgammon game. As I told you, this game is no longer played in India, but we found many places from the ancient times where it was certainly played. Okay. Then people have roamed around in Ellora and found games. Sojwal again found a Mangala at Sinnar. There are lots and lots of stories coming out. At Mandapeshwar in Mumbai, there have been findings. Okay. The alcock that I showed you earlier is from Mandapeshwar, one of the few examples of a proper alcock bird without wings. Okay. And some of these even throw up a few interesting cases. So here is one. This was a very simple cross-like game, and we never knew what it was. Was it a game or was it some other kind of ritualistic drawing? We were not sure. This was found in Nashik. But later on, when we were referring to game, we found a 1905 book which showed the same diagram and called the game as Udak Pagra. Okay, it's a very simplified form of chopper for children. But it is with this kind of luck that sometimes an extinct game can be brought back to life. But sometimes you get something like this. Now, is this a game? Is this an incomplete pachisi? Maybe it was meant to be fully scratched out as a pachisi, but then because the squares were marked wrongly, was it abandoned? Or was it a game that the players had made up and played, and then now that game has vanished? Okay, will we ever find another example of this game? So this is the sort of mysteries that our work sometimes throws up. And we hope you will also join us in this fantastic journey, that you will keep an eye out for ancient games cut into the floors of temples, forts, caves, and other monuments in your own area. And if you ever find something, please feel free to email me and inform me, and you will be given adequate credits, okay? So we have some papers that we've published as part of the proceedings of a conference we had in 2019. In 2020, the India Study Center Trust had another conference which I couldn't attend. And hopefully there will be a few more conferences and more people will come and talk about archaeopaizology in those conferences. And we also hope to publish as many of these findings as possible before they are flowed over, or if we can manage to publish a critical volume that comes to the attention of the ASI, of the state departments, and they take these games into account during their restoration processes, and that even the general public gets enough interest so that they notice the games on the floors of their temples, and they don't unnecessarily obliterate them. Okay? Thank you very much for your patience.